So what we're going to look at now is the relationship between the inter-process communication time and both the individual and the mutual clock drift that I described to you. Let mu be the lower bound on the inter-process communication time. So let's now derive the conditions under which we can assert that if we have an event A on PI, and in real time, it's supposed to precede an event B on PJ, what are the conditions that should hold in terms of mu, k, the individual clock drift time, and epsilon, that is the mutual clock drift time? This first condition is pretty straightforward. It is coming from the fact that ideally, if the clocks are perfectly synchronized, you know that at time, real time t, ci of t and cj of t should be exactly the same, right? You expect that. If the clocks are perfectly synchronized and it is keeping with real time, ci of t is equal to cj of t, equal to t, where t is the real time. But there could be individual clock drift and mutual clock drift, which makes them different from each other. And all that we are seeing through this first one is that this is the act of sending a message, and this is the act of receiving the message. The timestamp that I'm going to give to this, the real time that I'm going to give to this by reading my clock, it better be higher than the time at which this message was actually sent. And in order to guarantee that, we have to look at what would be the time that it takes for this message to go from here to here. That's coming from this mu, the lower bound on IPC. So if the message is sent at ci of t with respect to pi, then the time on pi when this message is received over here is going to be ci t plus mu. This is the local reading of the clock when the message would have arrived at pj. So this is the time elapsed between sending the message and when my peer should have received the message. So what we are saying is, in order for making sure that PJ will have a timestamp that is at least greater than CI, you want to make sure that the time reading that I have on my local clock, T plus mu, should be greater than the time reading at the time that I sent the message. So at the time that I sent the message from PI, my peer's time was CJ of T. And all that we're saying is, in order to make sure that there is no anomaly, the first condition has to hold that says that the disparity between the two clocks is within this inter-process communication time. That's all this is saying, that the disparity of the mutual drift is within this inter-process communication time. And the second equation is basically a difference equation formulation of the formula that I gave you, which I call PC1. And this is basically saying that if k is 0, when I read the clock at time t plus mu and see the difference between the clock reading now and the clock reading when I read it at time t, it should exactly be mu. But because of the fact that I may have individual clock drift, it may not be exactly mu, but it may be something different from mu, either more or less, but very small difference. And so all that we are saying is that the amount of individual clock drift should be negligible compared to the inter-process communication time. So the first thing is saying that the inter-process communication time is much bigger than any clock drift that exists between two different clocks. And the second equation is saying that the individual clock drift is very small compared to mu. And if we put all of these things together, you can derive the expression for inter-process communication time, what it should be relative to mutual drift and individual clock drift. If this inequality is satisfied, you can avoid anomalies in your distributed system. So informally, what you expect is k is very, very small, which means that the denominator is very close to 1. So all that we are saying here is that the mutual clock drift, which is represented by epsilon, is very small compared to the inter-process communication time, which is what is captured by this condition that I laid out here.